Everybody, so we are gonna do Annie on the Mind. I have my earphones with me, so that's good. Chapter 15. We had the cocoa, and Miss Stevenson and Miss Widmer had drinks, but even though for a minute or two it looked as if we'd be able to talk, that didn't last long. Miss Widmer was the first to realize that we never got around to the introduction Miss Stevenson had requested when we went down to the kitchen. She put her hand out to Annie and said, "I'm Catherine Widmer, as Eliza's probably told you, and that's Isabel Stevenson."
"Hi,"
Annie stammered.
My name is Annie Kenyon. I'm a friend of Liza's."
Miss Widmer smiled wryly and said,
You don't say.
And we all laughed. We laughed again when Annie and I explained, a bit self-consciously, about the saucepan helmets. But after that, we all got very stiff, Annie and me hiding behind our cups, and Miss Stevenson and Miss Widmer hiding behind their glasses. Miss Widmer and Annie both tried to talk, but Miss Stevenson just sat there, not exactly glowering, but not very friendly either. And I couldn't say a word. Finally, after about 10 minutes, Miss Widmer said, "Look, I guess we're all too upset to sort this out tonight. Why don't you two go home and come back tomorrow for lunch, maybe? Or..." Miss Stevenson glared at Miss Widmer, and she went on quickly, Or after lunch. That would be better. Say around 2. Annie looked at me, and I nodded, and then Miss Widmer walked upstairs to the front door.
We stripped the bed,
Annie said shyly, putting on her lumber jacket again.
"We could take the sheets to the laundry for you."
"That's all right," said Miss Stevens. Said Miss Widmer, although she looked a little startled. "But thank you." She smiled, as if she were trying to convey to us that everything would be all right. But I saw that her hand shook as she opened the door, and I hurried Annie out ahead of me. I walked Annie to the subway, but she was both too upset to talk. Oh, but she and I were both too upset to talk. Annie gave me a quick hug right before she went through the turnstile.
I love you, she whispered. "Can you hold on to that?"
"I'm trying," I said. I'm not even sure I... I'm not even sure I said I love you back to Annie, although I know I was thinking it, and I know I thought it all that night when I couldn't sleep. Miss Stevenson and Miss Widmer seemed all a little calmer the next day, outwardly, anyway. But Annie and I were both quite very nervous. Miss Stevenson came to the door in jeans and a paint-splattered shirt over a turtleneck. Her hair was tied back, and there was, I was glad to see, a brush in her hand.
Hi, she said
a little brusquely, but smiling and seeming more relaxed and like herself, at least the self that I knew. She put down the brush. "Come on in."
"Ka,"
car?"
she called up the stairs.
"It's Liza, Nanny. Be right there,"
Miss Widmer called. And Miss Stevenson led us into the living room. The orange cat was lying on a neat pile of Sunday papers, jumped into Annie's lap as soon as she sat down. He curled up there, purring.
"He likes you,"
observed Miss Stevenson, awkwardly, taking off her painty shirt and throwing it into the front room.
"I like him too. I like him too."
said Annie, stroking the cat. Then Miss Widmer came downstairs, in jeans also, and I thought about there being two comfortable old shoes and wondered if Annie and I would ever be like that.
"Well," said Miss Widmer, sitting down on the sofa, "I don't suppose any of us really knows how to begin." She smiled. "It's funny, but the first thing that comes into my head to say is, how did you sleep last night?"
"Horribly, horribly," said Annie, smiling also.
"You too, Liza, right?"
I nodded.
Well,
said Miss Widmer again. Said Miss Widmer again. "At least we're all starting out equally exhausted. How about some coffee or tea or something to sustain us?" Annie and I both said yes, and then while Miss Widmer went down to the kitchen, Miss Stevenson sat there with us for a few painfully silent seconds, and then she went downstairs too.
"Oh, God,"
Annie said when she was gone,
"this is going to be awful."
The black cat came into the room, tail waving gently, and tried to nudge his brother off Annie's lap. I found a catnip mouse. Under the coffee table and was just getting it for him when Miss Stevenson and Miss Widmer came back upstairs with tea things on a tray and a big plate of cookies that none of us ate.
"What?"
asked Miss Stevenson abruptly when we'd each taken a cup of tea.
"Have you said to your parents?"
"Nothing," we both said at the same time.
"Do your parents know about you?"
We looked at each other.
"Not really," I said. "I mean, I haven't told them or any. I haven't told them." "Yeah, I haven't told them or anything. Once in a while, we've gotten yelled at for coming home late or not calling," said Annie. "And Liza's father has said a couple of things about exclusive friendship and things like that, but that's about all."
They're going to have to know. Miss Widmer said gently.
"At least yours are, Liza. Mrs. Poindexter isn't going to keep quiet about this."
"It was wrong of you to use our house like that," Miss Stevenson said, putting her cup down.
You know that, I think, but, well, I guess one of the things I remember last night was Ka's help." She looked at Miss Widmer. It's just how hard it is to be 17 and in love, especially when you're gay. I was too angry last night to think very carefully. But, well, I think I should tell you that despite all the things I said about trust, Miss Widmer and I might very well have done the same thing when we were 17. Especially, said Miss Widmer, if we'd had a house at our disposal, which we didn't. Annie's eyes met mine, and then she looked at Miss Stevenson, and Miss Widmer said,
You mean you've known each other that long?
Yes, said Miss Stevenson, but that's another story. I'm afraid that right now we have to deal with what's going to happen next. She patted her pockets as if looking for something. Miss Widmer pointed to a pack of cigarettes lying on the coffee table. Miss Stevenson reached for them and lit one. As I see it, she said, we have two sets of problems. One is the accusation that's going to be made against you two, which really just means you, Liza, since Annie's not at Foster. That's why you'd better decide pretty quickly what you're going to say to your parents. And we also have the accusation that's going to be made against us. Against Ka and me. We went for another hour or so, talking, and trying to anticipate what was going to happen, and trying also to figure out how best to handle it. I guess it helped. It made us feel a little better, anyway, but it didn't do anything. It didn't do any actual good. After we left Cobble Hill, Annie and I went to the promenade and walked until it was time for Annie to go home.
I think you should tell your parents, Liza, she said.
I know, I said uncomfortably. But how? I mean, what am I going to say? Sally Gerald and Miss Baxter caught me and Annie making love at Miss Widmer's and Miss Stevens' house when we were supposed to be taking care of the cats.
If you jam your hands any deeper into your pockets,
said Annie quietly, stepping in front of me and pulling them out, you won't have
any pockets. Look, she said, facing me, I don't have any right to say anything, because there's no real reason so far for me to tell my parents, and I don't think I'm going to, in spite of what I said before. But
why not? I interrupted.
Just why not?
Because I think it would hurt them, Annie said. I've thought about it now, and I think it would hurt them.
It'll hurt them to know you love me?
I said bitterly, turning my own pain on to her.
No, Annie said. It might hurt them to know I'm gay. They like you, Liza. You know that. Nana loves you, and they would understand about loving friends. But then they wouldn't understand about being gay. It's just not part of their world. So you're going to spend your whole life hiding after all, right? Even after saying all that back at the house while we found the books?
I knew I was being rotten, but I couldn't stop myself.
I don't know about my I don't know about my whole life, said Annie angrily. I was okay about right now. I was okay. I just know about right now. Right now, I'm not going to tell them. I don't see why you can't understand that. Because you seem to be going to tell your parents. You seem to not. Because you seem to be going to not tell your parents either. But you want me to, I said, trying to keep from shouting. There were other people there. There were other people on the promenade. As usual, an old man glanced at us curiously as he shuffled by. And then I said the words, surprisingly. Surprisingly me, and then almost as quickly and surprising me, and then almost as quickly as surprising me. Look, maybe I don't want to tell them till I'm really sure. That I'm gay, I mean. For a moment, Annie stared at me. Maybe that's my reason, too, she said. Maybe I'm not sure either. We stood there, not moving. Liza, said Annie, the only reason I said I thought you should tell your parents is because all hell's going to break loose at Foster's, and someone's going to tell them anyway, so it might as well be you. But it's really none of my business. Especially, she added, since all of a sudden neither of us is sure. She turned and walked away, fast, toward Clark Street, as if she were heading for the subway. All I could think of then was that Annie was walking away from me, angry, and that I couldn't bear that. It hit me that I could probably bear anything in the world except her leaving, and I ran after her, putting my hands on her shoulders to stop her. I'm sorry, I said. Annie, please, I'm sorry. You're my lover, for God's sake. Of course it's your business. Everything about me is your business. Annie, I love you. It's crazy, but that's one thing I am sure of. Maybe the other being gay, having that label just takes getting used to. But Annie, I do love you. Annie gave me a kind of watery smile, and we hugged each other right there on the promenade. I'm not used to having a lover yet. I whispered into her hair, I'm not used to someone else being a part of me like this. I know, said Annie. Neither am I. She smiled and pushed me away a little, touching my nose with the end of her finger. That's the second time in about 2 seconds you've called me a lover, and the third time in 2 days. I like it. Me too, I said. That must prove something, Annie said. And then we walked some more, wanting to hold hands, but not daring to, in spite of the fact that we just hugged each other in full view of what seemed to be like to be half of Brooklyn. We never did decide about my parents, and I realized when I got home that I couldn't tell them. With Chad around anyway, or didn't want to. He was around all evening. By the time we were going to bed, I could have told them, but I convinced myself that I might as well wait until the next day to send what Miss Poindexter to see what Miss Poindexter was going to do. I didn't have very long to wait. As soon as I walked in the front door, Miss Baxter beckoned me to the front desk in the office. I tried to face her as if I had nothing, but I had nothing to be ashamed of or embarrassed about. But I needn't have bothered, for she didn't even look at me. "Miss Poindexter wants to see you," she said grimly into the papers on her desk. "Thank you," I said. She didn't say, "You're welcome." I certainly wasn't surprised that Mrs. Poindexter wanted to see me, although I hadn't expected she'd get around to it so quickly. I had also expected anger from her. Not what I found when I walked into her ugly brown office. She was wearing black again, but this time without the lace. And she was slumped down in her chair, the way she usually carried herself, so unlike the usual way she carried herself so rigidly, sitting or standing. That Chad and Anne often joked about. How she must have swallowed a yardstick as soon as she'd grown 3 feet tall. But that day her shoulders were hunched. Her head was buried in her hands. And she didn't even look up when I came in. I stood there for a minute, not knowing what to do. The only thing that moved in the whole room was the minute hand on the clock on the wall, and that moved so slowly it might as well have been still. Finally, I said, "Mrs. Poindexter, you wanted to see me?" Her shoulders gave a little quiver, as if she were sighing from some place deep inside herself, and at last she looked up. I was shocked. I was so shocked I sat down. Without waiting for her to invite me to, her eyes were red around the edges, as if she'd been crying or not sleeping, and every wrinkle in her sprinkled face was deeper than before, as if someone had gone over each one with a pencil. "Eliza," she said very softly. "Eliza, how could you? Your parents, the school, oh..." She moaned. "How could you?" "Mrs. Poindexter," I stammered stupidly. I didn't mean... Shh. She sighed again, audibly this time, shook her head, and reached for the Kleenex box on her desk so she could blow her nose. "I don't know where to begin," she said. "I don't know where to begin," she said. "I simply do not know where to begin. This school has nurtured you since you were a tiny child. A tiny child. How you could have gone so wrong. How you can be so ungrateful. It's beyond me, Eliza. Simply beyond me. Ungrateful." "Ungrateful?" I said, bewildered. "Mrs. Poindexter, I'm not ungrateful. Foster's done a lot for me, and I've always loved it. I'm not ungrateful. I don't understand what that's got to do with anything." Mrs. Poindexter dropped her head into her hands again, and her shoulders shook. "Mrs. Poindexter, are you all right?"
"No,"
she said, her head snapping up.
"No, of course I'm not all right.
How could I be when Foster is not all right?
You, those teachers, just when...
She put her hands flat on her desk as if to steady herself and brought her voice down to its normal register again. Eliza, she said, you are 17, aren't you? I nodded. Quite old enough to know right from wrong, indeed. Until now, you've shown a reasonable sense of morality. That stupid incident last fall. Notwithstanding, this may surprise you, but... Here she smiled. She smiled ruefully. I have even always felt a begrudging admiration for your stand on the reporting rule. Naturally, in my position, I've not been able to support you in that. And, of course, I have never been able to agree with your stand. Because of experience has taught me that most young people are not to be trusted. I've admired your idealism, however. But now you... Oh, God, I thought. Why can't she just yell at me? Eliza, she said, looking out the window. I met Henry Poindexter, my dear late husband, when I was 17. If it had not been for me and my strong... If it had not been for my strong religious upbringing and his, we would have been weak enough to make a serious mistake within a few months of our meeting. Do you understand what I am talking about? I nodded again, surprised and trying not to smile nervously at the idea that there had ever been anything approaching passion in Mrs. Poindexter. Even at the idea of her being 17. Then I realized she couldn't see me, so I said, yes. So I understand the pull that sex can have on the young and inexperienced persons. I do not understand the pull of... She finally turned and looked full at me.
Abnormal sex. But I am, of course, aware of adolescent crushes and of adolescent experimentation. As it precludes to normality and normalcy. In your case, had I only known about your unwise and intense out-of-school friendship in time.
I felt my whole body tightening. Mrs. Poindexter, I said,
it's not...
She cut me off.
Eliza.
She said almost gently,
I am going to have to suspend you. I am going to have to suspend you. Pending an expulsion hearing, of course. You know I have the authority to act without student council under extraordinary circumstances. Which, when you are calmer, you will agree these are. I think you will understand that if it weren't for the fundraising campaign, we might have been able to handle this more delicately. But if one whisper of this scandal goes outside these walls...
Her voice broke, and she closed her eyes for a moment. Then she pulled herself up and went on. A public scandal, she said, would only mean the end of Foster's campaign, but the end of Foster's as well. She looked at me quite severely, but I didn't know what to say. And of course, she went on, you must be punished for using someone else's home. For using someone else's home in that way, no matter how much encouragement you must have received from the owners. But, I said, horrified. But Miss Stevenson and Miss Whitmer didn't. She ignored me. She closed her eyes again and spoke quickly, as if she'd written out the words and memorized them the night before. You understand? She said mechanically, without even anger showing any more, that it is impossible for you to continue as president of student council, and that it would be unwise and unhealthy for both you and the other students for you to come back to school until this matter has been resolved. Sally and Walt have requested that you be removed from all participations in the student fund drive. Words stuck in my throat, anger and tears. She held up her hand. Her eyes were open now. Therefore, I am asking you to immediately go to your locker and pick up your books and other belongings. And I will give you the text of your speech to Sally, who will revise it if necessary and deliver it on Friday at the rally which you will not attend at any circumstances. There will be a trustee's hearing about your expulsion and about what notations will appear on your record and if of in okay of in okay here we go of in fairness to the student and teachers at MIT. Your proclivities, if firmly established, which I cannot believe they are in one so young, should be known. In fairness to yourself, too, I dare say, to ensure that you will be encouraged to get professional help, you will be notified of the trustees' hearing, and you may attend and speak on your own behalf, and because this is so serious a matter, you may bring an attorney if you must, and if you will, of course, your parents. The board of trustees will be at the meeting. Will at that time make a decision specifically about notifying MIT. Eliza, she said, this is very much for your own good, as well as for Foster's. I do not expect you to see that now, or to see it as difficult for me as it me to act so firmly. But I have no choice, and someday you may even thank me. I sincerely hope so. Not because I want thanks, but because I want. Because I want to think that you will be. Healed and regain your moral sense. Whatever is necessary to set you right again. She reached for her telephone. Oh God, I thought panicking. I should have just told Mom and Dad last night. I am now calling your parents, though it pains me to do so. I know it is my duty, and I pray that they can help you, and that they will see to my intention to be absolutely fair. She began dialing and said, You may go. Again, not looking at me, Mrs. Baxter glanced up as I came out of Mrs. Poindexter's office and passed by the central office. The central office. When she looked down again, I noticed through my numbness that her lips, that her lips were moving as if in prayer. Annie, what does being fair mean? I think they were trying to help me at school. I think even Mrs. Poindexter thought she was helping me, especially by talking about immorality. But really, what is immorality? And what does helping someone really mean? Helping them to be like everyone else, or helping them to be themselves? And doesn't immorality mostly have to do with hurting people? If Sally had pierced people's ears against their will, that would have been immoral, it seems to me. But doing it the way she did was just plain foolish. Using Miss Stevenson's and Miss Widmer's house without permission, that hurt them. And was immoral as well as sneaky, but Liza stood as she crumpled what she'd written so far to Annie, but then smoothed it out again and hid it under the blotter on her desk. But, she thought, looking out again at the wet snow, what we used the house for, was that immoral too? I've been saying yes so far because of the hurt it caused. Before I went home that morning, I went down to the basement to clean out my locker. Luckily, not too many kids were free first period. Still, there were a couple hanging around down there, including Walt. I tried to avoid him, but he gave me a kind of obscene grin, as if even though he didn't want me in the campaign, he now counted me as one of the guys. I could almost imagine him asking me how Annie was in bed. Then, when I thought a couple of other kids were looking at me funny too, I told myself I was just being paranoid. That Walt had probably grinned out of embarrassment only. But then, when I got to my locker and opened it, a note fell out of it that had obviously been slipped in through the crack. Liza Lezzi, it said. I didn't get home till halfway through the morning because I'd been walking on the promenade to put off facing Mom. As soon as I got in the door, I could see she had been crying, but she was really great to me. There's no question. She tried quickly to put her face back together again, and she put her arms around me right at the door without saying anything and held me for a long time. Then she pulled me inside, sat us both down at the sofa, and said, Honey, it'll be okay. Someday it'll be okay. Believe me. I put my head down in her lap, and for a while she just smoothed my hair. But then she put her hand there, under my chin, and gently lifted me up.
Liza,
she said,
I know what it's like to have no close friends, and then suddenly to have one. It happened to me, too, when I was a little younger than you. Her name was June, and she was so beautiful, I had to remind myself not to stare at her sometimes. We loved each other very much, the way you and Annie do. Maybe not quite so intensely or quite so exclusively, but very much. There was one night.
Mom looked away, blushing a little, then said shyly,
There was one night when June and I slept in the same bed. At her house it was, and we kissed each other. And then for a while, we pretended one of us was a boy, until it got so silly and we got so giggly we stopped. Honey, lots of girls do that kind of thing, and boys too.
Maybe boys more than girls.
It doesn't mean anything unless... Well, I don't suppose I have to draw any.
Pictures?
You're nearly grown up. But what I think I'm trying to say is that feelings, sexual feelings, can be all mixed up at your age. That's normal. And it's normal to experiment.
I couldn't help it. I knew I had to leave or blurt out angry words I'd be sorry for later. She was making it impossible for me to tell the truth. I wasn't sure I wanted to anyway, but how could I even think of it now? I wrenched myself away from her and ran into the bathroom, where I let the cold water flow until it was near ice and splashed it on my face. Over and over, I tried to think. I tried so hard to think, but there was only one word in my mind, and that word was Annie. When I went back into the living room, Mom was standing at the window looking out at the new leaves on the ginkgo tree outside the window.
Look,
she said, pointing to a small gray bird darting among the branches.
I think she's building a nest.
She turned to face me and put her hands on my shoulders.
Liza, she said, looking into my eyes, I want you to tell me the truth. Not because I want to pry, but because I have to know. This could get very unpleasant, you know that. We can't fight. We can't fight it with lies, honey. Now, have you and Annie done any more than the usual experimenting? Experimenting is, I know, a bad word, but I think you know what I mean. Has there been any more than that between you? More than what I told you, just between me and June? Her eyes were somber. There was fear in there. Such fear and such pain and such love. As well as that, well, I'm not proud of it, but I make no excuses, but I lied to her. No, Mom, I said, trying to look back at her calmly. No, there hasn't. The relief on Mom's face was almost physical. I hadn't been aware that she'd looked older when I came in, but now she looked herself again. She even seemed a little cheerful, at least in comparison with before. She patted me on the shoulder and said, Well then, now let's just try to talk about what really did happen.
and about why Miss Baxter and Sally and why Miss Baxter and Miss Sally misinterpreted whatever it was that they saw. It was a good thing in the way that Dad came in as soon after, because I couldn't concentrate on Mom's questions. All I could do was say over and over in my mind, "You lied to her. You lied to your own mother for the first time in your life. You lied." When Dad came in, Mom had called him at the office. I found out later, and he'd come home in a cab, and not even waited for the subway. When Dad came in, his face was gray. Mom got up from the sofa immediately. I couldn't move and said, "It's all right, George. Liza isn't sure why Mrs. Baxter and Sally got so mixed up. But it was all a terrible mistake. I imagine that both Miss Baxter and Mrs. Poindexter overreacted. Especially Mrs. Poindexter. You know how old she's getting. And the campaign is so..." But I could see right away that Dad wasn't paying any attention to that. He wasn't even hearing it. Mom sat back down on the sofa next to me. And Dad looked at me, right at me, with his honest brown eyes, and said, "Liza?" And, "Oh, God," I said, "Dad, can I get you a drink?" "No. No thanks," he said. And he went into the kitchen himself and made drinks for him and Mom. "Look," Dad said carefully, sitting down in the big chair, "this is hard to say. I don't even know how to begin to approach this, but I, first of all, I want you to know that I'll go along with whatever you decide to do, Liza. I'll support you, whatever's true. You're my daughter." I keep saying that to myself over and over again in the cab on the way home. She's my daughter. "My..." "George," Mom began, but he ignored her. "You're my daughter," he said again. "I love you. That's the main thing, Liza, always." He smiled weakly, ear piercing and all. His smile faded. "But I have to tell you, Liza, and I've said even less to your mother about this than I've said to you, except when you've been late. That as much as I like your friend Annie. That as much as I like your friend Annie and admire her singing voice. Fond of her, I am. I haven't been blind to how intense you are about her, how intense you both are." My stomach felt as if icicles were forming in it. "George," Mom said again, she had taken only one small sip of her drink. She was holding it as if she'd forgotten it, and any moment would slip out of her hand unnoticed.
"George, adolescent friendships aren't like that. Intense. Adolescent friendships are like that. Intense, beautiful."
She put her arm around me.
"Don't spoil it. Don't. This is awful for Liza, for all of us. It must be awful for poor Annie, too. And think of Miss Stevenson and Miss Widmer."
"Yes," said my father a little grimly. "Think of Miss Stevenson and Miss Widmer." My mother looked surprised. the icicles in my stomach extended slowly to the rest of my body. I've always wondered about those two, Dad said. Then he slammed the drink down. Oh, look, he said. What difference does it make if a couple of teachers at Foster's are lesbians? Those two are damn good teachers, and good people too, as far as I know. Miss Widmer, especially. Look at the poems Chad's written this year. Look at how good Liza suddenly got in English. The hell with anything else. I don't care about their private lives, about anyone's. At least I... He picked up his drink again and took a long swallow. Liza, damn it, I always thought you was. Well, okay about things like... I always thought you was... Liza, damn it, I always thought I was, okay about things like homosexuality. But now, when I find out that my own daughter might be... She's not. She told me she and Annie are friends only, Mom insisted. I wanted to tell Dad then. I wanted to tell him so much I was already forming the words. And if I hadn't already lied to my mom, if we'd been alone then, I think I would have. Liza, my father said, I told you I'd support you, and I will. And right now, I can see we're all a little too upset to discuss this very much. So in a minute or two, I'm going to take you and your mother and me out for lunch. But honey, I know it's not fashionable to say this, but, well, maybe it's just that I love your mother so much, and you and Chad so much, that I have to say to you, you've never thought gay people can be very happy. I've never thought gay people could be very happy. No children, for one thing. No real family life. Honey, you are probably going to be a damn good architect. But I want you to be happy in other ways, too. As your mother is. To have a husband and children. I know you can do both. I am happy, I tried to tell him with my eyes. I'm happy with Annie. She and my work are all I ever need. She's happy too. We both were, till this happened. We had a long, large lunch, trying to be cheerful and talking about everything except what had happened. Then my mother took me shopping, saying we might as well use the time to start buying me clothes for MIT. But really, I think she took me so that Dad would be the only one when Chad came home from school. On the way back to the apartment, Mom and I stopped at the fish store and she brought swordfish, which I love. And she cooked all my favorite things that night, as if it were my birthday. But it was a tense meal. Anyhow, with Chad speaking only when somebody else talked to him. He wasn't meeting my eyes, even when he and I were talking, which wasn't often. After dinner, I called Sally. I didn't know quite what I was going to say. Something like, I'm sorry it got to you the way it did. But she hung up on me. Later that night, when Annie called, I was so worked up but all I could do on the phone with her was cry. So she called back later and talked to Mom, who said yes, I'd be okay. And we'd all get through this, like, and things like that. I imagine it wasn't very reassuring. The next morning when I woke up, the sun was shining underneath my window. Underneath my shade. And for a second, everything was all right. I'd been dreaming a wonderful dream about living with Annie. And when I woke up, I think I really expected to see her beside me. But of course she wasn't there. And then everything came crashing in again. Sally's shocked face, Chad, Mom, Dad. As if the air were heavy and pressing down on me and making it hard to breathe. I tried to imagine what it would be like if people always reacted to Annie and me that way, being hurt by us, or pitying us, or worrying about us, or feeling threatened, even laughing at us. It didn't make any sense, and it was unfair. But it was also awful. I could hear Mom moving around the apartment, and I didn't want to see her. So I lay in bed for a while, watching the sky flicker under the shade, and trying not to think anymore. But then I remembered I still had to give Sally my speech. So I got up and dressed, wanting to get it over with as soon as I could. Before I even got to Sally, I decided to wait for her outside school. I called two juniors. I passed two juniors in front of the main building, and one of them was saying something like, "I'd rather have Miss Widmer any day than a dried-up old substitute." The other one said, "Yeah, but they got to teach art." "Yeah, but that one they got to teach art, she's not so bad. I mean, at least she's young." I didn't hear much more. Either I turned it off or they stopped talking. Of course, I told myself, since I'm suspended, Miss Widmer and Miss Stevenson will be suspended too. If I'm having a hearing, so will they, probably. But then there was Sally. It was funny, I remember it in the outline form, sort of, with Sally and me, like, shadow figures facing each other on the steps. I said hi, or something equally normal. But Sally just stared at me, so I said stiffly, "Here's the speech. Look, I'm sorry I forgot yesterday. I'll help you rewrite it if you want." It was as if she hadn't heard me. She was still staring at me, shaking her head and ignoring the speech, which I was still holding out to her. "How could you?" she said very softly. "How could you? With a girl? I just can't believe. I mean, think if anyone else had found out. Someone outside. Walt said it could kill the campaign. People should control themselves if they felt that way." It's so disgusting. I'd been wanting again to tell her that I was sorry she'd been so upset, but now I was too angry. "It doesn't have anything to do with you, Sally," I heard myself saying. "You don't have to be disgusted. But she was still shaking her head. "Oh, yes, it does have to do with me," she said. "Everything about a person has an effect on others. Everything. Look at the ear piercing." I tried to tell her that those two things were different, that the piercings weren't the same thing as loving someone, and that she was making all the wrong connections. But as I pushed my speech into her hands, she said, "Loving, lusting." "Loving? Lusting, you mean? Read your Bible, Liza." Miss Baxter showed me. It's even mentioned there. "Read Leviticus. Read Romans 1:26. I don't know what I said then. Maybe I didn't say anything. I'm not sure I was able to think anymore. I do remember, though, that I went home and read Leviticus and Romans and cried again.